Hey, Bob. Hi, Betty and John. How are you guys? Everybody have a good lunch?
Had a good lunch. We're back.
Good. Well, I'm going to continue from this morning, since we only got partway through.
Hello.
Hey there, Armando. How you doing?
All right.
Okay. So as I said, I'm going to continue on from this morning. We have lots of other stuff to still look at. And Wednesday, I'm going to introduce you guys to a lot of the early Renaissance artists and architects that you might want to know about. Okay.
Hi, can you hear me?
I can hear something
it's
way off.
Naomi.
Oh, okay. It's like you sound like you're in a tin can, Naomi.
Well, as long as you could hear me, it's okay.
I can now. Okay. Yeah, you're coming in a little clearer.
Good. Okay.
Anyway, so I'm going to actually introduce you, like I said, to some early Renaissance artists on Wednesday morning. And we're actually going to look at some of the work of a couple of some of the artists who worked in the Renaissance who were women, who we don't often hear about, okay? And, you know, this may be a surprise to some of you, but there were a few of them, okay? So anyway, let's get busy, all right? And I'm gonna start with the share back where we left off at. And I'm a little, let's see, where am I at? Nope, not that guy. Sharing the wrong one.
Now,
we're not ready for him quite yet.
Can you show something that is not religious?
Can I show, well, that's gonna be hard to do if we're talking about the Renaissance.
Oh, okay.
Okay, because the Renaissance, they were all about.
What age is Da Vinci?
He was Renaissance.
Okay.
But he was more to the middle of the Renaissance. Okay, so anyway, I'm gonna stop sharing. Okay, and let's try this again. Let's try to get the right one. There we go. Okay. But here's the thing. You need to understand how we got to Da Vinci, right? And how we got to Caravaggio and those people. If you don't understand the context of how we got to that style of painting or sculpture or architecture, then you know you've only got part of the story. Okay. So we left off here. Again, you know, this is the inside of that Gothic cathedral. The guy right there on the right, the Siena Cathedral. And as you can see, the change in architecture basically opened up that space and it gave artists a lot of opportunity to design and to create images that would kind of convey the ideas that the church was trying to portray. So, that was a fairly large advance step in architecture before a lot of the churches and things like that had all been very dark and kind of, there were a lot of columns in the way. You know, you couldn't really see around these things. So it really didn't afford you an opportunity to really show off a lot of art. And moving into, you know, these Gothic cathedrals really kind of expanded that space out. And so it gave you opportunities, you know, to create like altarpieces like this. that would sit up at the front of the church. And again, you know, this is Lucio. So he's still in the Middle Ages at the beginning of the Renaissance. And the Renaissance really started, you know, right at about 1300 is the date that they give to it. Again, this is another one of his paintings. And again, look at the style of it. It's, you know, it's beginning. Here's a close-up of it. It's beginning to take on some of the look of some of the Renaissance work in the sense that, you know, the people are beginning to look a little more individual, you know, and not just sort of copies of the same person or really stylized as much. The form isn't quite as flat. It's beginning to look like it's got some volume and form to it. Now, there's the actual altarpiece itself. And again, this is, I think I read somewhere, this was tempera. It's tempera on wood. And so, you know, you got the main scene and then you've got all this, the rest of the saints and the story of Christ, you know, from his birth really to his resurrection, you know, in this one altarpiece. Let's see, go down a little bit further.
Question.
Yes.
Do you think the wood lasts longer than the canvas?
It does actually.
So they should be using more wood than canvas?
Well, in the Renaissance, and particularly like in the Middle Ages, most of those pieces that have survived were all on wood panels. And in fact, you know, artists still paint on wood panels today for that very reason. You know, wood, it's pretty stable. It's gonna, if, barring the fact that it's exposed to extreme weather conditions, you know, or extreme fluctuations between heat and cold, it's going to hold up pretty well.
Have you tried one?
I paint all wood panels all the time. You know, and in fact, I'll take wood panels and I'll make my own panel by taking like a wood substrate and then putting linen on top, adhering it, and then I paint on that. And I've also recently started making my own panels with foam, like foam board, what they call gator board. So you take a piece of gator board, you do the same thing, you know, you cover it in like a gesso or a acrylic, you know, like heavy gel medium, adhere the linen to it, wrap the edges, and then prime it in a color.
I'm not sure I'm familiar with that gator board. I'd probably know it if I saw it.
Yeah, it's like a heavy foam board. You've seen it before at the Benson Center.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Anyway, so here's another artist, Lorenzetti. And now let's see. So that's, he was around 1338 was when this painting was done. And if you will, take a look at it just for a second, and what's different about this painting than some of the others that we've seen so far?
These are the same size and they're pastel colors.
Well, okay, yeah. So now all the figures are more in scale to the environment that they're in, right? The buildings are bigger, you know, they feel like they're inside of a city wall, right?
Right.
Okay.
Perspective. Two vanishing points.
Right. Yeah. You see, and the perspective is getting a lot more advanced, isn't it? These are beginning to take on almost a naturalistic feel. Right? And it's still a little bit flat, but it's not nearly as flat as some of the earlier medieval paintings and some of the other early Renaissance paintings. Okay? So, again, you know, we're right at about, you know, 1340 and in time, And if you start thinking back historically, what was going on, you know, during that period of time, you know, again, you know, this was a pretty explosive time as far as growth, and the fact that just look at the dress of the people as well. You know, you can clearly see that really by this period of time in the early Renaissance, you started having what we would call a merchant class, you know, or we call it a middle class today. And so that had never existed before, right? Again, you know, we came out of this really feudal system where you had, you know, royalty, and then you had a craftsman class, and then you had, you know, the paupers, or, you know, the peasants, right? Well, none of these people here really look like peasants, and they're all beginning, you know, they look like workers, and, you know, people who, you know, are pretty, what we would call cosmopolitan, you know, they live in the city. So again, you know, society was changing, you know, pretty rapidly at that point. You know, here's a painting again. Now this is by Giotto's master, Cimabue, and look at the scale of the painting, but also, again, you know, it's a very traditional, you know, medieval or Gothic painting. See, again, you know, the figures are a bit flat. You know, they don't have the dimension and the form that, you know, some of the artists moving into the Renaissance had. Okay. So let's see real quick. Okay, let's keep moving because I want to get through this. Okay, yeah. So here's a good comparative slide between Giotto's master, Cimabue, and Giotto. And an interesting thing happened. You know, Giotto was younger, obviously, and Cimabue was the master. So he taught Giotto how to paint. But Giotto pushed it, and he was innovative. And he started using, you know, different techniques to try to create more dimension and more form, you know, in his figures, and they became more lifelike. And because of that, you know, Giotto basically really overshadowed his master, you know, the person who taught him. So, you know, there's a goal for you, you know, learn to paint better than the person that you're learning from. Okay? And the only way that you do that is observation and looking at lots of different things. You have to be extremely curious and sort of hungry, you know, and want to continuously learn about different techniques and different processes, and take those, experiment with them, play with them, make them your own, and, you know, come up with something that's unique to you. And that's basically what Giotto did. Again, you know, looking at, you know, how the figures were treated. And okay, let's see who's, okay. This is a different artist. And again, you know, this is like an altarpiece, you know, and they're beautifully done. But again, you know, when you compare this to Giotto, it doesn't seem to have the weight or the form, you know, to the figures. So let's see. Yeah, we saw that. And we just looked at that. Okay, and there's Giotto's Madonna enthroned. So let's move forward.
This is Bob. Got a comment?
Sure, Bob.
Mm-hmm. You know what I've noticed basically between the Gothic and the Renaissance is the fact that the artists seem to be learning how to use light in their work. I mean, that's the biggest single thing that I see is how they managed, start to manage basically the, where is the light coming from and how is it affecting the people or the images that are fundamentally built into the, whatever the piece of work they're working on.
So how do you think they did that?
I have no clue.
I have no clue. Okay. Well, it goes back to that word that we mentioned earlier called chiaroscuro, right? And what chiaroscuro is all about is about light and shadow. And again, you know, it's trying to emulate nature and what light does, you know, on the surface of the skin or on the surface of a building or, you know, any other object. And when artists, particularly in the early Renaissance and late medieval period, began to make observations that, okay, you know, your skin color is a particular color, but depending on, like when you're looking at my face or I'm looking at yours on this computer screen, I can see that there's light coming from a particular direction and part of your face is in shadow, part of it's in light. So if I paint it all the same color and value, it looks flat. If I begin to add light and shadow, see, that's copying nature, right? And that was kind of the big break, you know, in the Renaissance was, you know, they began to go back and do more observation from nature. And they became curious and wanted to answer a lot of these questions, like why and how do we paint a building to make it look like it actually sits within a particular space? And the thing you'll notice is as the Renaissance moves on into the middle and the later Renaissance, artists become very, very proficient at creating and turning form. You know, they begin to understand perspective, both atmospheric as well as like what we call linear perspective for buildings. And so anyway, we're gonna look at a good collection of Giotto's work right now. And really the reason that he is so important, that's not what I'm sharing, is it? No. Okay. All right. So can everybody see, let's see, what am I on? Okay. It should be, it's called The Ascension of John the Baptist. Mm-hmm. Is that what everybody's seeing? Okay, yep. Good. All right. So I'm on the right one. You have several windows open. It gets a little confusing sometimes. But you begin to look at this and again, you know, look at the forms. And of course, this piece is not in the best of condition. But you begin to look at the shapes and the forms of the figures and you can begin to see that they begin to have volume and they're not quite so flat. And as Bob pointed out, you know, there's a definite sense of light and shadow. Okay. You know, on these figures. Now, he's got other pieces here that I'll be happy to show you, like this one. And again, see, they're beginning to take on a little more naturalistic look. You know, they don't look quite as though they're copies of the same face over and over and over again.
I have a question. This is Wanda.
Yeah, Wanda.
When it comes to the Renaissance beginning, middle, end, whatever, are we going to be covering some of the people of color in European art?
Well, there were a few, you know, there were in Italy at the time, and remember this is post-Roman Empire. And during the time of the Roman Empire, there were people from all over the world, including, you know, Asia, Africa. And so one of the things we're going to be talking about in particular are some of the Spanish artists, which were also came from a Moorish background. And this is Spain during the time of the Renaissance, because there were things going on there as well, particularly more around the middle Renaissance. Okay.
So there was none earlier than the Middle Renaissance, you're saying?
I wouldn't say that there were none. I would say that there's not a lot of historical data on them.
Okay. But my question is, will we be covering some of those drawings, those paintings?
Yeah, well, we will, you know, and particularly as we get into the Middle Renaissance. We're right now at the very beginning of it. So once we get into the Middle Renaissance, and particularly in Spain, as I said, there were artists from Moorish descent there. You also had a collection of women artists in the Middle Renaissance that were, very good artists that a lot of people don't hear about. So I'm going to be trying to talk about a good variety of,
There are a number of paintings in Russian museums that are people of color of different Christian stories. Are we going to be covering those? I think they came before the they did come before the Renaissance and probably before the Byzantine Empire era.
Yeah, those are probably more Byzantine. Okay. And so that was a little before the Renaissance. And most of those would have been done around the areas of what is now Turkey, around Constantinople, in those areas. So yeah, we're kind of past that. But again, if you're looking at artists of African descent in the Renaissance period itself, and in the Renaissance, you have to keep in mind, you're primarily talking about Italy, but you're also talking about Spain and England, as you move into the middle and the late Renaissance, okay? And we're gonna be talking about all of those things, all of those places, and how things were going on in each of them and how they differed, okay? Because if you wanna really understand that period of history, you can't just look at Italy, because Italy was not, the center of the universe. It was just a place. And there were certainly some advances made in Italy, and that got things moving all throughout Europe, okay?
So then there are, I've seen some pictures, just like the one you're showing right now, but it was of African-Americans. And it also had some...
were they African or African-American? Because you have to...
They were Africans, because America wasn't even then yet. But they were Africans. When they were Moors... But they showed them in such a way, just like this painting that we're looking at. Mm-hmm. And I saw a lot of them.
Well, there was a lot of Byzantine art that had a lot of African, African, Moorish, Spanish, artists, in that period of time, before the Renaissance. And then remember what happened. From the Byzantine period, we basically went into what we call the Dark Ages, right? And for almost really about 500 years, there was almost like no painting done, period. People were just barely scraping by, at that point. And again, that's where you went from, the Roman Empire, which was a fairly egalitarian sort of society, and you had a variety of all kinds of people there, to this feudal system in Europe in particular. Now, the same thing didn't happen in, say, like North Africa. There was a whole different thing going on there, and that was in the Islamic empire, all right?
So, a lot of these early patriarchs were painted and with people of darker complexions and different textured hair. And right. It was thought that they were eventually colorized and made to look like they were Caucasian when they were originally of a darker race. And they are in, this was before the Middle Ages on display, and they weren't necessarily done by those artists, but a variety of artists did them.
Right. Well, now, again, Byzantine period, you have, there is, like in Russia, there's a pretty extensive collection of what they call Byzantine art from the Ottoman Empire. And yeah, there's a lot of African people, you know, or people of African descent, you know, in those, you know, in those paintings, because that would have been fairly common in that area to see. Now, when you get to Italy, you know, at say the very beginning of the Renaissance, I'm not so sure that there were a lot of, you know, people of African descent in that area at that time. And so a lot of the paintings that you see from Giotto and, you know, a lot of the Renaissance artists in Italy, you don't really see a lot of African figures there, right? But now when you, if you go to Spain, maybe like 50 to maybe 100 years later, when you're really in the middle Renaissance, then you begin to see a lot of influence, you know, from the Moors and the different varieties of people there. Again, because, you know, they painted what they saw, you know, and what they experienced. So like I said, as we get into that period, you'll begin to see, you know, probably a wider variety of different types of people. Okay.
Yeah, because the paintings that I saw had a lot of Africans in high levels of society.
Yeah.
Kings and ownerships of different things. And
right.
And even though the paintings may have been of different colors in there, the African was the main feature of the painting.
Yeah.
Which I thought was very nice.
Yeah, during that Byzantine period, and if you look even at the Ottomans, right, you know, who, the Ottomans were not your standard Turks, right? They weren't people originally from Turkey. You know, they were the Moors who came in and conquered Turkey and were the rulers of that area, or that whole area, what they call the Ottoman Empire, and they were of African descent. Mm-hmm. Okay, and it was very common, and in fact, you know, during the Byzantine period in particular, you look at a lot of the royal families, both in England, Germany, what's now France, things like that. They intermarried.
Summary from Wikipedia: England-Germany football rivalry is considered to be mainly an English phenomenon in the run-up to any competition match between the two teams. Many UK newspapers will print articles
speaking. Who is that?
Yeah, I don't know, but yeah, if they could. Anyway, let's move on. Okay, we'll get there. Okay, so let's try not to get it too far ahead of ourselves. Okay. All right, so we're back on Giotto, and again, you know, I'm just sharing some of these pieces. Again, look at the use of color in this piece. And again, you know, he used a lot of blue. And again, you know, blue was a very hard pigment to acquire at that period of time. And, you know, it was expensive. And, you know, basically the church was his main patron. So they were really, you know, the only ones who could really afford to, you know, supply an artist with that kind of material. Okay. Now later on, you know, when you get into
what was the blue made from?
It was a mineral that came out of Afghanistan. It's called lapis lazuli.
Oh, okay.
Okay. And okay. Literally, you know, it was a stone ground. Because it was really the only kind of blue that they could use up until really, I think it was like the 16 or 1700s,
mm-hmm.
The English started importing indigo out of India. Okay. But up until that time, you know, you basically had to use lapis or turquoise to create these blue colors that would be color fast and last for any period of time. You know, during the Renaissance, one of the things that kind of worked against them was the fact that artists were always experimenting and they were always looking for new materials. to create colors from. And in a lot of cases, they would use plant-based materials, you know, such as berries and things like that. And they would get some beautiful colors, the problem being that those colors were what we call fugitive. So they didn't last. You know, within a few years, they would begin to fade, and you would end up losing, you know, all of that color. Now, this is the inside of a chapel, and this is probably one of Giotto's key works. And again, this whole project is the whole life of Christ, from birth all the way to the resurrection. And so, you know, there's many, many different images. And some of the images that I'm showing you, you know, as we go through this, you know, are basically on the church wall right there, that chapel. And a lot of these things that are sort of these brownish tones that you see, at one point were probably, you know, had another pigment over it. And as you can see, you know, even the blue is beginning to fade and wear off over time.
When they painted on the wood, they didn't paint directly on the wood. They all put linen across over the wood.
They would put either linen, parchment, and or they would use a material that I think we've mentioned before, gesso. And what gesso is a mixture of like it's calcium. It's a calcium base. And so what that does is that helps keep the oil from seeping into the wood, because oils have, well, oil paint, or paints and pigments in general, have acids in them and can break down what we call the substrate, or the thing that you put it on. And that's why, you know, when you buy a canvas today, if you turn the canvas over and you look on the backside of it, it looks like a piece of, you know, like material, right? On the front side, it's white. Well, that white, well, generally it's white. Now they come in black and gray, and you can get them actually in different, you know, different colors. But now, you know, they go ahead and they pre-prime that surface so that it's covered and protected, so that when you paint on it, it doesn't begin to eat away at, you know, the substrate that you're painting it on. Okay. Now I want you to look at this painting in particular, because this is the Last Supper, right? Now, this is about 120 years before Leonardo da Vinci would paint his Last Supper, okay? And we'll look at the two of these, and I'll go back to this, so that you can begin to compare, you know, the difference in how they each approached, you know, this subject. But again, you know, this is on the inside of that chapel. Okay. All right. So there you have somebody of African descent. Okay. Wanda, don't miss it. Okay. And he's actually one of the people, yeah, what they're doing is they're whipping Christ. This is before his crucifixion, is part of the story. So let's see. All right. And then this is a altarpiece that he did, and it's for a different chapel than the one that we saw. And again, you know, these are all on wood panels. You know, so each of these are a section of wood panel that fit into this frame. And again, you know, it kind of goes back to the Gothic style. You know, and again, so you have that size relationship. So you're really still not quite out of the Middle Ages. You know, it goes back and forth for a while. So like I said, on Wednesday, and particularly Wednesday morning, you know, I'm going to be trying to introduce you guys to probably some names you haven't heard so much about. We're going to be talking about a couple of architects in particular. There's Lorenzo Ghiberti, and another is Filippo Brunelleschi. And really, when you get to Brunelleschi, that was really the kind of turning point, you know, away from the Middle Ages and really clearly into the Renaissance. And everything after that was pretty much so, you know, Renaissance art. And so we're going to be talking about both of those. We're going to be talking about an artist by the name of Donatello, who was a sculptor. And he did a bronze of David. And it's not anything like the David that most people think of. So we're going to be looking at that. Masaccio, Franangelico, and Paolo, is Uccello, I think, is the last name, or Uccello. And we're going to be going over them. We're going to be going over some of their art and the relevance of what they did and how they moved really from that medieval period, you know, into clearly the Renaissance. And again, you know, the important thing to take away from all of this is you don't only have a change in the art, but the fact is that art and the evolution of art really reflected an evolution in, you know, the society itself and what was going on historically with people. And so, you know, if those social changes hadn't happened, you know, more than likely we would still be painting, you know, very much so in the Gothic style, and everything would be very kind of graphic and flat and stylish. But, you know, because ideals changed, not just in visual art, but in writing, in philosophy, and all these different aspects of life, you know, we have these changes happen, you know, to the visual arts as well. Okay. Anybody got any questions about any of that? And I'll do my homework. I'll look for more, you know, more artists. When I'm looking for more women, I'll also look for more artists of African descent, and particularly if there were any in Italy. I'm not aware of any, but, you know, right now. But that doesn't mean they weren't there, so.
And not so much the artist as the artwork.
I'm sorry?
It's not so much as the artist. Mm-hmm. I want to see the artwork.
Okay. With the piece that we showed by Giotto?
Any piece that has Africans in it, at that particular time.
Okay. Well, the fact is, you know, I mean, at that point, that's post-Roman Empire. And like I said, you know, the interesting thing about Rome was anybody could be a Roman citizen. It didn't matter where you were from. And it didn't matter, you know, I mean, race was totally irrelevant during the Roman Empire. It was more of a class type system. And whether or not you had, you know, various skills to offer, you know, or what your talents were. And again, you know, during the time of the Roman Empire, you had what we call social mobility. You know, you could start off in a poor family and yet, you know, work your way up. And in fact, you know, it was not totally uncommon in Rome for somebody to start off as a captive, as a slave, and then work themselves into being free, and then attain a great deal of wealth. And in a lot of cases, some of those people became Roman senators and actually became politicians in Rome. And so,
Charles, I thought, did I read somewhere that Michelangelo's mother was from Tunisia, which is Africa?